The session that we're now going to run through is to look at the importance of selling ideas and concepts. From the day's program, we're going to just gradually build up through various management skills and management type procedures. But we have to start off with this basic concept, and perhaps one of the great responsibilities of all, certainly in the marketplace that we're all living in, ladies and gentlemen, that the modern professional manager must have a good understanding of what selling is. But also the modern manager must have the ability to sell ideas and concepts. We are no longer living in the authoritative world of dictatorship. Do this or you're fired. Do this or else. That's not a modern management skill, which means we must be able to develop our skills of communication, of persuasion, which in turn means one must have a good understanding of what selling is all about. And there's a lot of nonsense that is talked about selling generally throughout the United Kingdom. Perhaps we're only just starting to value that selling is kind of important. Over the years, it's been devalued as a profession. Generally, you know, nice people don't get involved in selling, a lot of organisations think. But if we are realistic about it, nothing happens anywhere in the world until a sale takes place. It's quite extraordinary, though, the overall buying public and their reaction to selling. I can make two very simple examples. Gentleman in the front row. So what is your name? Charles. Imagine Charles and I met, let's say, in America. I'm not going to be saying that everything is right in America, by the way, but let's, in this instance, I want to give you an example. Charles and I, let's say, met in a bar, and Charles said to me, "And what do you do?" And I might say, "I'm a salesman." More than likely, he would say, "Oh, really? What do you sell?" Now, the same conversation here in England, Charles and I might meet, and he'd say to me, "And what do you do?" And I might say, "I'm a salesman." He'd say, "Oh, really?" And go off and find somebody else to talk to. Now, I'm highlighting that point because of this overall general reaction about it. I came across an article a little while ago. You'll be pleased to hear this is a bit more recent than the previous one I read out. 15 surprising predictions for 1984 and 1985. The person who wrote these is really rather interesting. A man called John Gomez, one of the most successful entrepreneurs in the whole of the United Kingdom. He keeps a very low profile. Perhaps his name is not terribly familiar to everybody. But some of his businesses, I'm sure, most certainly are. Penny Share Guide, Penny Share Focus, Fleet Street Letter. He's an extraordinarily successful entrepreneur on the London Stock Exchange. He speaks 17 languages fluently. He suffers from an insecurity problem, so he keeps £1 million in cash. I understand that helps a little bit. But number 12 of these 15 surprising predictions I'd like to read out to you. And it says, sales and marketing will at last be recognized as one of the greatest business skills in the world, the only one computers and robots can never replace. But there will be new, more subtle ways of selling to replace the distasteful hustling of recent years. Ladies and gentlemen, that's music to my ears because I think that's terribly important. We have a discerning public with a lot of choice, and for those who are involved in sales management, it is so important to upgrade the sales techniques when one is actually selling products or services. But I want to concentrate our thoughts right now from the management point of view of selling ideas and concepts to our staff. This whole process of communication. And the most successful organizations in the world are the organizations where the chairman of the board accepts that some of his responsibility or her responsibility is one of salesmanship and selling. Because in turn, at that level of communication, of course, one is selling big concepts or big ideas. But I'd like to begin by killing some of the myths of selling. You know, some people can, some people can't. Listen, I'm a manager. I'm definitely not a salesperson. I'm not going to get involved in it, and I don't want to know. But I really believe, you know, in all honesty, everybody is born a natural seller. We're all born with this ability. And you say, oh, no, that's not right. Oh, no, I disagree with you. You go along to the maternity hospital, you see all those newborn babies there lying in their little cots. They've all got little bands around their wrists for identification with their mother and their father and perhaps their birth date, and you don't see written alongside the band, another salesman in the world. I agree you don't see that. But would you accept that children are brilliant salespeople? Would you accept that generally? Yes? Anybody here got any children? Can I just see that one or two of you? The others, it'll catch on, you'll see about that. But if you take a simple example for a minute or two, take a five-year-old. A five-year-old child out with his daddy doing a little bit of shopping, let's say. And the five-year-old says to his daddy, says, "Daddy, can I have an ice cream, please?" And the father says, "No, You can't have an ice cream because you eat an ice cream now, you won't eat lunch, lunch is going to get spoilt, mummy's going to be upset, and then we're both going to be in trouble. Does the child say, oh fine, I quite understand that. Never mind, I'll ask again about 2:30 if that's all right. Child doesn't do that, does he? Child says, I want ice cream! And the father says, you're not going to have an ice cream, I made up my mind, that's all there is to it because you won't eat lunch. What does the child do? He asks again, I want an ice cream! And the father says, you're not going to have one, please, no more fuss, that's all there is to it. And what does the child do? He asks again. Some get so worked up, they lie on the pavement or the shop floor, screaming, kicking their feet in the air. Father goes off and buys one, brings it back and says, here you are, but don't tell mummy. Now, that's a classic sales presentation. Now, I'm not suggesting you've got to get in some office or other and convince some of your staff that you've got a good idea, or your chairman or whoever it is, you've got a good idea and you want them to take on your concept. You've got to lie on the floor, screaming, kicking their feet in the air. I'm not suggesting that. Might work, but I'm not suggesting it. What I am suggesting, though, is the basic principle. The basic principle of that is this. Everybody has this natural ability, but as people grow through their formative and training and development years, various types of conditioning set in. And there's a form of conditioning that is known as no-no conditioning. No-no. People understand the meaning of the word no. And this word no takes on such a powerful meaning in life that for some people, as they get out and develop, they actually decide to stop asking. Imagine for a few minutes if no did not exist, if nobody could say no to you ever, what would you be asking for all day? You don't have to admit to that, but of course, that's not the real world. That's not the real world. Of course, no does exist. But that's the first understanding. If we, all of us, with our concepts, our ideas, our enthusiasm for improvement or change or development, whatever that may be, if nobody could ever say no, we'd be much more forthcoming. And we must understand that perhaps as the basic principle of salesmanship and communication. No does exist, but so what if somebody does say no? So what? It's always a no before we've ever asked. Let's try and put selling also into some form of concept of to get a basic understanding of what it really is. Take a husband and wife at home. Hubby says, let's go to the cinema. Have you seen what's just come in? Tremendous film. It's got 4 Oscars, so-and-so. It is absolutely outstanding. The reviews have been incredible. You know, we haven't been out for a long time. Let's go out to the cinema tonight. And his good lady says, that is a nice idea, but have you seen what's on TV? Tonight's really worthwhile watching every program. It's one of the complete rarities. We haven't got a video, so we can't record it. Look, I tell you what, let's stay at home tonight. Let's watch this super evening, perhaps have an extra special supper, have a lovely cozy evening together. Let's do that tonight. And he says, yeah, that is a nice idea. I accept that, but you know, this is such a good film. It'd be such a shame to miss it. You know, they don't stay around for very long. They're here and they're gone. It's much more fun to see on a big screen with some good sound effects, a bit of atmosphere in the cinema, than it ever is to see it perhaps in 6 years' time or 2 years' time when it finally makes our TV screens at home. Let's go out tonight. Do us both a lot of good. Nice change. Come on, let's do that. And she says, yeah, that is a nice idea, you know. But it'd be such a shame to miss what's on TV with such a rare evening like tonight. And anyhow, we might not get in. Could be a queue. Might come on to rain. And anyhow, I'm going to make an extra special supper, have that at home in front of the TV. If it gets a bit cold, we'll make a nice cozy fire, and one or two other things might happen as well. Now, here we are. We've got a classic selling situation here. One person selling to the other. Now, we all know who's going to win in the example I've just given you, but that's got nothing to do with it. The point I'm really saying here, ladies and gentlemen, for all of us to understand, is that we are selling in every day of our lives. Whether we want to call it that has got nothing to do with it. We're selling our concepts and our ideas. But in our responsibility as managers, we must be able to sell these concepts more readily, more successfully, to make sure the communication process is really working well within our own organizations. Because strife is caused when communications break down or people misinterpret or don't like or won't accept whatever it is we're suggesting. So let's go through now one or two of the ideas that help us to be more effective in this process of persuasion. Perhaps the first stage is to accept that people actually buy people. People buy people. Not necessarily a product or a service, and not necessarily a concept or an idea. People buy people. And in the sales world, it's taught that, you know, people actually don't like doing business with somebody they don't like if they've got a choice. I think we'd all agree with that. You know, all of us here, we all buy things from time to time. If we've got a choice, we'll do business with somebody we like rather than somebody we don't like. If there's no choice, well, that's a different matter altogether. I remember one instance, to make this point, when I was farming, a fellow arrived on the farm one day and the conversation went a little bit like this. He said, "Morning, Mr. Denny. My name's Chris Bowles from Silcock Lever Feeds." He was selling a range of cattle and pig feeds. They're all the very same, all these things. He said, "I've just taken over the responsibility of this area." He said, "I'll be around again in a month's time. I expect you're very, very busy, so I won't hold you up for now. I'll leave my business card, and I'll see you next month, if I may." And off he went, and I thought, what a nice fella, nice chap. Month later, there he was again, came back on the farm, and he said, "Morning, Mr. Denny, you remember me? I'm Chris Bowles from Silcocks," and we chatted for a minute or two, and he asked me how things were going. I told him things were bad, because all farmers are trained to say that, you see. And we chatted a little bit more, and he said, "I'll be around again next month, see you then, if I may," and again, off he went. And I again thought, what a nice fella, nice chap. Really nice guy. Anyhow, month later, there he was again. And I remember as he came on the farm, I said, "Oh, hello, Chris." He nearly got me. And I was telling him about a problem that I had, that one of my calves wasn't doing very well. He said, "Well, why don't you try a bag of our calf food? It might do the trick." And he was a nice chap. I thought, give him a little order, keep him quiet, you know, maybe £2 or £3, you know, little tiny order. And I bought a bag of his calf food. Within about 6 or 7 weeks, I suddenly realized that Chris Bowles was supplying me all my cattle and pig feeds. He was doing the lot. Now, why? I didn't buy Silcock Lever feeds. I bought Chris Bowles the person. The point I'm making here, and for those of you again who are responsible in getting business, it is absolutely vital that all of us sell ourselves. And you know, the understanding of that. So many people say, "Oh, yes, that's right," you know, on sales courses that are run just for salespeople. One of the first things they say is, "You've got to get out there, my boy, and or my girl, you get out there and you sell yourself." And they say, "Yes, that's what I'll do." Woo-hoo! And off they go out the door, and then they get halfway out through the door. But how? How do you sell myself? I'm not for sale. How do I do it? You know, if one's selling oneself, the one thing one tries to talk less about is oneself, is to get the other person to talk. And that's such an important management style, again, is being interested in people. You know, you go to a cocktail party, you meet someone for the very first time, and you might say something like, "Oh, hello, and where do you live?" And they tell you where they live, and how long they've lived there, and the trouble they have with their next-door neighbours. And you say, "Oh, really? Interesting, huh? And what do you do for a living?" And they tell you all about the job, and how badly they're paid, and the trouble they have with their manager, and they're not understood. He says, "Oh, yeah, interesting. And got any kids?" "Yeah, they tell all about the kids. Produce the photographs and the school reports." "Oh, Been away on holiday?" "Yes, tell all about the holiday. Plane didn't arrive on time. Hotel wasn't built. And they had jippity tummy anyhow." 1 hour later, somebody comes along and rescues you. One goes away thinking, "God, Lord alive. Hey, that was heavy." The other person goes away saying, "Come and meet my new friend. Great conversationalist." You see, people love to talk about themselves. Now, I'm not saying this is a creepy, smarmy type of exercise. I'm saying it is genuinely fascinating to be interested in people. And the extraordinary thing is, again, you know, how easy it is to find something in common with almost any of us. If any of us here were to spend a little time chatting away, we would find something that we'd have in common with every one of us. You know the old expression, it's a small world. It's quite extraordinary how this happens. But imagine at the same cocktail party, you meet somebody for the first time. You're introduced, you say, "Hello, and where do you live?" And they say, "Oh, I live in so-and-so town." You say, "Really? How long have you lived there?" "Well, we only moved there at so-and-so." "Have you really? Well, whereabouts do you live?" "Live in so-and-so street." "Do you? Do you know so-and-so?" "Yes, well, do you drink?" But instant common ground. Isn't it extraordinary? When we find something in common with somebody, there is a relationship there. And again, if we take the trouble to find out about the people that we work with to help us through the other processes of life and the management styles that one adopts. So this first stage of the selling of concepts is to understand this point about people actually buy people and one must sell oneself. Let's go to something else, the second stage of selling concepts and ideas. And that is, again, a complete opposite to some of the old thinking about selling. If you were to say to me, "Richard, what do you consider to be the single most important factor that makes up the person who is really good at selling their ideas or their concepts or even selling a product or a service? What would you consider the most important factor to be? And I would say to you, is developing the skill of asking questions. Asking questions. You know, the old training and the old thinking about salesmanship was you've got to get out there and talk them to death. Talk them till they submit. Complete reverse. Ask questions. Ask questions and find out first of all. And in selling a new project to a group of people, ask the questions first of all because it helps to match up later on. Let me give you an example of that. A few years ago, we had our office in London. We were going to move out into the county of Wiltshire. And we wanted a telephone answering machine to take calls during this particular move. And we had three telephone answering companies came along. First one comes in with his machine, the salesman did, comes in with his machine, sits it down the desk, plugs it in, and proceeds to tell me all about the machine, all these features and benefits, and he tried to close me. I got rid of him. Second salesman arrives, he went through the same process, comes to the machine, he took me all the way through all what it'll do and everything else. He also took me through the guarantee, and he explained the instruction book in detail. Anyhow, I managed to get rid of him because he tried to close me there and then. Third guy arrives in, comes in, sits down. He didn't appear to have anything. And he starts to ask a few questions. He said, Mr. Denny, would you mind if I ask you a few questions in order to save a lot of time? I said, well, by all means. He said, well, can I ask you first of all, what do you want a telephone answer machine for? Guess what I said? To answer the telephone, yes, he said, I accept that. But how many calls a day will you be taking? What is your business? How long will those calls be? He asked me a whole string of questions, made some notes down. He said at the end of it, I think I've got just what you're looking for. He went back out to the car, brought back in an answer phone, probably the only one he got. He brought back in the answer phone. But guess who got the business? Because he had the courtesy to find out, first of all, and he matched up according to what I was looking for to what he had available. Now, that is a great principle of selling concepts and ideas. We're going to be talking later on, ladies and gentlemen, from the point of view of goal setting. And for those of you who perhaps might now react very strongly against this word selling and the importance of it, because, hey, listen, this is not part of my job. It is so important, as one of the great motivating factors of the management skills of all, is to find out what people want and then help them to achieve it. And by asking questions first of all and finding out, we then can sell the procedures and the methods and the codes of conduct and the practice to match up with those goals that we've already found out earlier on. My third point, my next point here, as far as these selling ideas and concepts, is to understand this word, and it's in no way is this meant to be a talk down, ladies and gentlemen, but just that one word, listen. Listen. Listen to what is said. Listen to what is not said. Because often we get far more information from what is not said as against what is said. It is such an important management skill to be able to ask and to listen and to truly listen. To truly listen. That's a lovely old adage. We've all been given two ears and one mouth, and that's the ratio they're best worked in. Nice little reminder that. Let's go to our next point here now. And that is, okay, that's all very well. We ask all these questions and we listen to what they say. But at some stage or other, we've got to convince them that what we've got is right. We've got to tell them, whatever it is. We've got to convince them. And the secret to be convincing, ladies and gentlemen, the secret of good persuasion is to sell the results. Sell the results of whatever it is you're suggesting. Let me give you a very simple analogy to make this point. Imagine somebody walks into an ironmonger's shop, hardware store, whatever you want to call them, and they go up to the proprietor and they say, I'd like a quarter-inch drill, please. And the proprietor says, no, you don't. The customer says, I know what I want a quarter-inch drill. And the proprietor says, no, 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 no. I don't think you really do. Now, who is correct? Well, we all know that the proprietor is totally correct. Nobody's ever wanted a quarter-inch drill, have they? Have they? What do people want? Quarter-inch holes! You can't buy those, can you? Now, let's look at that concept. Let's look at the concept there. Person walks into the ironmonger shop and says, I want a quarter-inch drill. The proprietor says, what do you want to make a hole in? Wood, concrete, steel, brick? I want to make a hole in some brick. How deep do you want to go? So-and-so centimeters. Oh, I've got a widget that'll do that. Have you? How much are those? You see, we must sell the results. That's what people want. And in selling our ideas across, we must make sure that it's the result that we're selling. It's the result that we're explaining clearly. That's the purpose of why we want it done this way. Because it's for the result, not just the stage-by-stage method of operation. Sell the result. A couple of years ago, I was taken on by one of the major building societies to do a fairly long, in-depth training and consultancy program with all their managers. And I've been briefed by the chief general manager. And part of my brief was, he said, we want you to teach our managers how to sell mortgages because we've got too many of them these days. Things have changed around. The old days, well, all of us here perhaps went along at some stage or other with, you know, pleading hands to a building site manager, can we have a mortgage, please? And they'd say, well, maybe. Well, think about it. But it's all changed now. They've got too many mortgages. They've got to sell them. They've got to get them out the door. And so my brief was, he said, I want you to teach our managers, apart from all the other management skills, on how to sell mortgages. And I said, well, I don't really think that's correct. He said, oh, yes, it is. We've got to sell more mortgages. We've got a crisis. We've got too many of the darn things. We've got to get them out the door. That's why I don't actually think that's right to teach them how to sell mortgages. Because I said, I don't really think people want to buy mortgages. He said, everybody wants to buy mortgages. Now, that's not really correct, is it? What do people want? Houses and homes and flats, that's what they want. They say they want a mortgage until they get one. Anybody here says, oh, I got a lovely mortgage. No, we hate the darn thing. But we tell everybody we want it until we got it, then we try and get rid of it as quickly as possible. It's the selling of the result that's so important. The whole communication is to sell the results across and make people clearly see the results. And again, the importance of that is the natural reaction of any human being is the one of the fear of change. And whenever there is change, the imaginative part of the brain nearly always operates negatively. Would you agree? New Methodists, we want it done this way. This is what we're going to do in the future. Instantaneously, people normally imagine the worst. My job's on the line. I'm going to be fired. Oh, it's going to be this. They're going to cut back on that. Normal reaction. So, clearly, sell the results. My next point of selling concepts and ideas, ladies and gentlemen, and that is the principle, make it easy. When you are putting across an idea of operation, whatever that may be, choose the easy way. Keep it immensely simple. And if you've got two methods to put across, which one should we do? Choose the easy one, because if it's easy, it'll have a far greater chance of success. So often in businesses, people complicate the systems. They complicate the management styles. They complicate it. But by keeping it easy, it'll have so much greater chance. So always keep the explanation and keep the process very, very simple.
Results Training Company is delighted to present the new Motivational Management Library with Master Communicator Richard Denny. Richard Denny has been labeled Britain's Guru of Motivation. He believes that motivation is crucial to success achievement and that people will perform beyond their own self-limitations if led by a motivated manager. Richard Denny has been a sales and management trainer since the early 70s. He has lectured in 14 countries around the world and is a sought-after speaker at conferences and conventions. He is the author of the best-selling book, Selling to Win, now translated into four languages. He is also the author and presenter of the video training course, The Professional Manager. He has written numerous articles on motivation, selling, management, and personal development, as well as being a regular contributor on radio and television, and as chairman of the Man Management Group of Companies. He is not just a theoretician, but a practitioner. Let's join Richard Denny in this series of cassettes edited from a live seminar with the theme, When the Leaders Are Leading, the Followers Will Follow.
The one thing that we all do have in common is our responsibilities of the management of people. And that's going to be the theme running through the whole seminar. And the objectives that I'm setting out to try and achieve, really, is to discuss management skills so that we can perhaps all improve our management skills. The second objective I want to try and aim for is that one of how we can all motivate the people that we work with more effectively. And then thirdly, and perhaps the most important of all, is how to win in a very competitive marketplace. Now, here we are in Britain, and I think for most organisations, we're finding that we are in a time of extreme competition. Our marketplace is certainly vibrant. Our buying public are more discerning. They're better educated. There's far greater choice. I believe the future is immensely exciting. But there's a lot of nonsense that is talked about the current situation. And I came across an article a little while ago that I'd like to read out to you that very much sums up the feeling that so many people actually do have about our current marketplace. And it goes as follows. It is a gloomy moment in the history of our country. Not in the lifetime of most men has there been so much grave and deep apprehension. Never has the future seemed so uncertain. The domestic economic situation is in chaos. Our currency is weak throughout the world. The political cauldron seethes and bubbles with uncertainty. It is a solemn moment. And of our troubles, no man can see the end. Now, that was written in a magazine called the Harper's Weekly Gazette in October 1857. And the extraordinary thing is that it almost could have been written yesterday. And no doubt there are some people working away, and journalists working away in Fleet Street, or I think nowadays they hang out in Wapping, don't they? Working on something like that to put out into tomorrow's media. And a lot of people read that sort of rubbish and they say, oh, it's right, of our troubles, no man can see the end, and the political cauldron is still seething and bubbling with uncertainty. So what can we learn? We can learn that we are still living through a dramatic time of change. Everything that we now take for granted has been created and developed since those words were first written. Aeroplanes, motor cars, synthetic fibers, the developments of medicine, people playing golf on the moon, and one can run on through this amazing list of creations and developments. So we are still, and we always will be, going through a time of change. But it seems that attitudes don't seem to change too much. And we're going to be talking a fair amount about attitudes as the day develops. I really believe, you know, ladies and gentlemen, that right now, for the future, anybody in business has nothing to fear whatsoever. And if we can develop the attitude of mind, not only within our own management teams, but also in the people that work with us, the principle and the philosophy of how can we do it better, as against that's the way it's always been done, why change it? There is, as I've just said, a tremendous opportunity. Certainly we've been conditioned over the last few months or so, the exciting potential of 1992. And we've seen some of the great captains of British industry extolling the opportunities that really do lie in 1992, as apparently Europe opens right up to us all. There's a marvellous story that makes this point so well about opportunity, and it's a story that relates to the diamond rush days in South Africa. And at that time, there was a farmer who heard about the enormous wealth that people were finding with diamonds. And this individual got caught up with what I can only best describe as diamond fever. And in due course, he sold his farm, and he set off, and he started to search the African continent to try and find this wealth that so many people appeared to be finding. And then over the years of having no success and no luck whatsoever, he became more and more despondent and more miserable, and then more and more desperate. And one day, in a total state of utter despair and frustration, he threw himself off a bridge and drowned. Now, it was just about that time that the person who had bought his farm happened to be walking through a dry riverbed. And they came across a rock of rather unusual shape and size. They took this rock away and they had it researched. And they found it to be a diamond of incredible value. They later discovered that the whole of that farm was covered in diamonds. and it later turned out to become one of the world's wealthiest diamond mines. Now, if only that first farmer who had owned that land had taken the two stages necessary in order to achieve the wealth that he personally wanted, was first of all was to learn what a diamond looked like in its raw and natural state. But secondly, he should have had a look to see what he already owned, because he owned acres of diamonds. And that story makes the point so well about so many people in our current marketplace as we are working through 1988 in Britain today. You know, so few people actually prepare themselves for those new opportunities, for those new challenges. So many people think the answer lies elsewhere as against making more of what they already have. And anybody, of course, who's been in business, certainly for a year, normally has a wealth of business back in their filing systems and their records that they can in turn pull out for the development of that business. But we can certainly talk more about that later on. So I believe that one of the great responsibilities of the modern professional manager is that one of preparing for the future. We can't prevent change. I'm not saying change is right for the sake of change, but we can't prevent change. So let's prepare and adapt and mould and develop our people so that they are able to meet those challenges, which is, of course, one of our great responsibilities in management. But how are people normally prepared for any given responsibility or any given career? There's a normal process. Let's imagine for a few minutes here, ladies and gentlemen, instead of a group of professional managers that we've got in this particular room, let's imagine that in our own company we take a new group of trainees on. And the normal process, when we take a new group of trainees on, or even one individual, we take them through an induction training program. And that's a very normal, simple process. I'm going to call this a circle of success and divide it into two halves. And the first stage, be it an individual or a group, we teach them about the products of our business. Whether we are a product-orientated business or whether we are a service-orientated business, we teach them about whatever it is our business is built upon. What is it we actually do? So they get good product knowledge. The second stage of this training program with a new group of trainees is we then show them the how-to. How to do the job they've been hired to do. If they're a telephonist, how to work that piece of machine. If they're a lathe operator, how to operate the lathe. If they're involved in selling, how to go ahead and make a presentation, close the sale and bring back the business. So we actually teach them the how-to knowledge. So let's go back to the scenario I'm just creating here. We're a new group of people, we've just joined our company. We train them identically on the product side of our business. We train this group identically on the how-to, and now we send them off to work. 6 weeks from today, we pause and we have a look to see how well they're doing. And my question is, ladies and gentlemen, would they all be doing as well as each other? Would they? No, they wouldn't. But why wouldn't they? We've trained them identically. They should all be performing as well as each other. One can say, oh, no, Richard, that's not so, because they may be working under different managers or out of different offices or in different areas. There's an element of truth in that. But there's a very big reason as to why they wouldn't all be performing as well as each other. So let's recreate this circle, but this time divide it into three parts. As before, product knowledge, essential to have that for believability, for credibility. People must have a good belief and a good understanding of the business that they're involved in. Secondly, the how-to, of course that's absolutely vital, so people know what to do and what is expected of them. But then we come down to this third segment, the big variable, very rarely ever taught in school, college, university, or place of further education. The big variable down the bottom there that can make an amazing difference in anybody's lifestyle. And that, of course, ladies and gentlemen, has to be attitude. How somebody thinks and feels. Are they positive or are they negative? Are they enthusiastic or are they in all misery guts? Now, I'd like to suggest to you that a person perhaps could be weak in that segment of product knowledge. They could be weak in that segment of the how-to skills. But if they have the right attitude, there is always, always a success story. But if somebody's got the wrong attitude, they'll never, ever be able to achieve their full potential. Would you agree with me on that point? Absolutely vital. So here we are, all of us here, with a responsibility, with a tag, director, manager, whatever the key word is that you've got in your own careers, with this great responsibility that we all have, we all say, yes, attitude. Give me the people with the right attitude. Everything is possible. Now, if that is so, and they're not going to get it from those places I just ran through. It must be a responsibility of all of us to help our own people to have the right attitude. And it must be one of the great responsibilities of modern professional management to teach what the right attitude is, so that we can help our staff. We can help them to achieve their own goals. We can help them to achieve the company goals, or the business goals, or the organisational goals that we're aiming for, by helping them, again, to approach it with this big thinking approach, this positive attitude, which is going to be, again, one of the themes of our time together. But, you know, perhaps the most valuable asset that we all have has to be our mind, our thinking process. And it's extraordinary, this, really, to a certain extent, how people actually don't value the mind. It's our mind, it's our brain that takes us through our careers, it takes us through our lives, it earns us our living, it pays the mortgage, it takes us into retirement. But how do we actually value it? How do we really care for it, in all honesty? Let's make a very simple comparison as to how people actually look after their motor car, for example. Because I believe that people look after their motor car more effectively and they take more care over their car than they ever do as against their most valuable asset of all. You've seen this, no doubt, in every village, every town, every city throughout the countryside, particularly Saturday and Sunday mornings. You see men walk out of their houses towards their motor car, carrying with them pails of water, sponges, shampoos and cloths. And have you noticed men bathing their motor cars at weekends? Have you noticed that? They do, don't they? And then they lift the bonnet up and, oh, they say it's still in there, and they close the bonnet back down again. And then you see men do things to the inside of their cars that they'd never, ever be caught doing inside their homes. They vacuum the interior. And then every so often, these same people, they send their car off to a garage to have what is called a service carried out on it. Now, you're going to have difficulty believing this, I know you will. But you know what they do? They then proceed to spend sums of money, like 70, 80, 90, sometimes even £100 on having that car serviced. I knew you wouldn't believe it, but they do. And they do it because they feel that if they don't give this loving care and regular maintenance attention to it, the darn thing will pack up on them and they'll be walking to a telephone that doesn't work. So they try and prevent that from happening by this regular maintenance, loving care and attention. I make that very simple analogy, ladies and gentlemen. You know that a day like today is a bit like a car service. It's a chance for everybody here to stand away from your offices, stand away from the telephone, stand away from your own staff, away from the pressures that we all have in our day-to-day lives. To stand back, hear one or two old ideas, hear maybe one or two new ideas. But above all, it's a recharge to our system, because the very role of management is a draining exercise. It's giving to other people to help them to perform better. So today is a little bit like a car service, but I also make the analogy as well that I believe it's a responsibility of all of us in management to understand that from time to time we become jaded. Perhaps we're not on peak performance, and we must understand again with our staff that sometimes they become jaded and sometimes they are not on peak performance. We would never run our motor car for a whole year without giving it a service or a recharge or a checkover. And so it is so important to help people revitalize their systems by some form of learning, reading books, cassettes, videos, whatever it is, and we're going to be talking more about that as the day develops. Perhaps it's only polite of me at this stage to explain a little bit of the background of what happened. I was farming on a fairly small basis in Sussex for a number of years, and during the latter end of the 50s and through the 60s, it was very, very difficult to make a reasonable living, and it was very difficult to earn a sufficient amount of money for what we really wanted to create for our standard of living. And I was looking around for other ways of supplementing our income. And on one particular occasion, a friend arrived on the farm and he said, "Richard, do you want to make a lot of money?" Now, I don't know what you would say if somebody says that to you, but I obviously said, "Yes, I did. What do we have to do to make a lot of money?" And he said, "Well, we needed half a dozen eggs." Well, I couldn't possibly see how you could make a lot of money out of half a dozen eggs, but I thought I'd humour him. Anyhow, we got together six very large eggs that the packing stations wouldn't take in those days because they hadn't got machinery to cope with a big egg. So they used to break them out for egg white and this sort of thing. A lot of them were double yolkers. So we put these very large eggs into an egg box, and we put a feather in the egg box and a little piece of straw because this was going to be the presentation. And we took the eggs to a grocer's shop in Knightsbridge in London that you may have heard about, called Harrods. And we were showing the eggs to the buyer there, the provisions buyer, a man called Mr. Bowen. And I was telling him all about these eggs, and they're straight from the countryside, and they were fresh, and they were brown, and he could actually see that. But we got around to the price, and he said to me, he said, "How much are your eggs?" Now, in those days, large eggs were selling for 3 shillings and 6 pence a dozen. So he said, how much are your eggs? I said, to you, Mr. Bowen, these eggs will be 7 shillings a dozen. He then ordered 300 dozen eggs. Now, I didn't have any eggs and I didn't have any chickens. I was a dairy farmer. But there was a lot of profit. And what we actually did is we went and borrowed eggs from our poultry-keeping friends. We had to borrow a van, I might add, as well, because we didn't have anything to deliver them in. We were given some egg boxes, we packaged them, and we delivered them, and we eventually got paid. And I mean eventually. But it was during that period of time, well, I was trying to find ways of making this business succeed. I certainly wasn't qualified, and I went to various seminars, and I read a number of books, and I went on a number of courses to learn about selling, about management, about marketing, a whole range of different things. I used to particularly like a Sunday paper, because nearly always in a Sunday paper, there'd be an article about a well-known, very successful man or woman, and somewhere in the article, the lines nearly always came up. The interviewer would say to the interviewee, sir or madam, what do you consider to be the major factor that's helped you achieve this amazing success in your life? And I used to wait for those words. I was nearly always disappointed with what they said, but I thought, why try and reinvent the wheel? Why not use ideas that have worked from other people? And it's those ideas I'm going to pass on today. I'm going to make a promise to you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not going to suggest one single idea that has been created in some ivory-towered learning establishment somewhere or other that's never actually been used in the real world with real people in a real competitive marketplace. We're going to stick to ideas that in most cases, perhaps I've learned from other people, but many of these ideas are going to be ideas that work. It's extraordinary when one comes to ideas and learning from the point of view that just one idea can tweak something up in a different direction. How important it is for us to understand in the training world, when we are training some of the managers or some of the staff that work with us, how we can help them to adapt. And we can never expect instantaneous response or instantaneous result. And I'd like to give you an example of what I mean by that. Let's take a plank of solid oak, 18-inch thickness of oak. Now, what's the average age in this hall here today? Shall we say 25? Yeah. Imagine a piece of oak, 25 years old, that has been stored undercover for 25 years. Would you agree with me? That would be a very hard piece of oak, almost like steel, it'd be so hard. Now, we get a nail on the top here, a 6-inch nail, and we want to drive that nail right down into that piece of oak. Are we going to do it with one hit? Are we? No, we're not. We could get a pneumatic hammer, and we would not be able to drive that nail in with one hit. It would buckle, it would shoot off, whatever happens, but we could not do it. But you know, a child could drive that nail in, perhaps even with a wooden hammer, with a sufficient number of small taps over a sufficient period of time. Tap, 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 and eventually the nail would go in. Now, the point I'm really saying here is perhaps one of the great principles of helping our own staff to perform better, and perhaps it relates to ourselves to a certain extent, in changing ideas or changing modes of practice. You know, just one hit, are we going to do it? Of course not. But over a period of time. We're going to talk about the importance of repetition, because right now the use of audio cassettes to play in motor cars is a great form of repetition. I personally have a cassette library. I'm regularly playing in my own motor car. And I can listen to those cassettes perhaps 50 or 60 times. And the extraordinary thing is this. Every time I listen to a cassette, I'll take something out that's different. The words on the cassette don't change, but my attitude changes. My experience I've just had, or where I'm going, or the mood, or the weather, or the economy, or whatever, is changing all the time. So we're all the time pulling out ideas. The importance of repetition in the guidance of people is absolutely vital.